about kernel function tracing, and then I will talk about the how we see and claim some issues which may impact the kernel function tracing. And that Alan will try to give some ideas or proposals about how to automate this special function tracing and how to make tracing easier. So this is the target program type we try to use. And so we target on a kprop and f entry and f exit. And if you look at the small bullet, and I have a few examples, that's what bullet and the user are recommended to do. Basically, you have a kprop of f entry, and you have a program name, you have a list of parameters. And in the EPR program, user can just use these parameters to see small bullets. And these parameters actually is taken from source code. And in most cases, this will work. And, but in some cases, if our function signature gets changed, and then this may not work. And the user need to do some special inspection to the source the door for assembly and try to get a proper list of parameters. And the rest of part, and I will talk about some difficult cases for function tracing, and especially about inlining and explicit function name changes. And for GCC, it's like a constant propagation, like the RSRA or R actual inlining, all these things. And for clan and currently, and clan may change the function signature, but no suffix. I have a patch for that, and I actually merged it this morning, but backported because some test error. And I will talk about implicit inlining. That means if you have no inline, actually inline still happens. And finally, some static and variable names and in multiple places. Simple example about inline. This is specific function in the BTF key is actually in the kernel BTF syscall.c file. And this function is completely inline. And if you look at the symbol table, and basically graph function name with a system.map, and you find it nowhere for this thing. So actually, it's inline. And if you grab the basically the particular file, and you can see actually there's two colors for this function. And how, in this case, if people indeed want to trace this function and the BTF copy key, what do they do, right? And you first need to basically do some analysis, try to find exactly in the binary and this BTF copy key, the exact place and the instruction sequence. So in order to do that, you need a easily store and try to through the inlining to find out exactly who inline who, and starting from bottom of the BPF copy key, or you can actually use a BPF object dump and search this keyword and try to exactly find out and exactly what color it is. And it is a from a function, and currently only kprop will support that. So entry f exit doesn't really support. So this one is an example if, and how do you really find the places and in order to do a correct tracing. And the left hand side is the part of the door. So look at the we have a door tag inline subroutine. So it will show which function actually is completely inline. And it has a PC, basically engine PC. It has a list of ranges. This range actually cover this function. And at the bottom, and it has a location. And the lo location actually it also shows a register, which register actually could be used and for inline and particular parameters for the inline function. So if you look at the right hand side, this assembly code, it roughly will correspond to the DOF. And well, it will be associated with DOF. And this function, they do a lot of stuff. And at the end, and this red line, and you can see, and if the register 9 actually is used, and they just test whether the size is 0 or not. So this is the way. And so this address 159A152 and actually exists in DORF as well. So if you try to automate, actually, and or try to do not want to see assembly code, you may just use this DORF information to find the offset. And after computer inlining, there's also selective inlining. Selective inlining is the same function. It may be inlined in some cases, but not inlined in some other cases. This is actually is confusing. Some people find, okay, this symbol in the symbol table and just attach, okay, since everything is fine, it may not be fine. And some people, some function are inlined, you are missing that. And in order to do that, you need to try to go to assembly code as well, or go to DOF as well, and try to find all the cosine, and which basically this function is called at a particular place. And also the inline subroutine, which is the inline instances. You need to do that. And for this LTO, basically it's a file based, it's a bit easier. And for the LTO, and it will be much larger scope. You need basically many, many more functions. And this is a function called code space. The code. And not code suffix, and this actually supported by both CPC and the CLAN. For CLAN, it needs a profile feedback, and CPC does not. So, and with a Google patch, and try to do the auto FDO, and they will add this split machine function and try to generate a profile feedback. And so if with this function, basically, and with the profile feedback, and the CLAN actually will be able to generate the code as well. So let's look at some of these functions. And this particular function, and space equal is in kernel bcf verifier.c. And you can see there's a function over here. One over here actually is dot code. And dot code will jump to here. Well, it's far away from this section of code. And it just two instructions and jump back. I don't know why I generated this code, because it's just a simple jump. But this illustrates the code section and could exist. And I tried and plot and the code section with addresses of the simple plus offset for this prompt event through the command line here. Echo P something to the keyprop event. It seems all working fine. So we don't really have issues here. Okay, this is the CLAN part. And in CLAN, in depth, document elimination. This again, and the instance happens in many places in CLAN, and in this particular case is cisco.c. And there are three functions in this file, and the signature get changed. And the map update element, map delete element, and string and copy from BPF enter. And this is a brief description. And basically, I call remarks in LLVM. It will show and one function gets changed and what the signature changes to. In this particular case, and the map update element, there's two arguments. And the first is a pointer, unfortunately. The second is a struct. And the struct in actual API, it becomes the struct byte is 16 bytes. It becomes two elements, two parameters here. And two parameters, one is used, another is not used. So actually, the compiler remove one of them. So just compare the red line and between before and after. You will see that. You can also see the single name is exactly the same here. There is no difference. And this is a continuation and to see. Previously is for the map delete and the map update. This is the inline function. The inline function is in the header file. It doesn't mean it will be deleted. Actually, in this particular case, this inline function becomes a static function. And for this static function, this size minus one, and actually is a constant. So remove this parameter. It becomes with three and license, kernel, and this size of license, the three parameter become two. And you can compare the result here and here as well. And again, the name is the same at this point.
I have a question about the declare this argument elimination. Did you check that how the debug information?
Debug information, just give me a second. I will show you next slide. This is the debug information. And the debug information in this particular case, the function, this is a generator function, and the debug information is responding to the source code. And you can see here, and there's a map update element, two debug information, two arguments here, and one is type and BPF, basically, here, and I think the type probably is another place. Just to show the parameter name. Another is this BPF pointer T, something like that. So the debug information corresponds to the source.
So those are let's say that the eliminated argument is eliminated or let's say that the assigned that the constant variable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's why it's gone actually. Yeah. And it is not reflected here. This is just the original source code. And again, this is basically the information and the before and after. And you can see basically one of the parameters is gone. And you just mentioned, right? And the parameter is, the signature gets changed, and we really want to know that. And in LLVM currently, and at least up to now, function name will stay the same. I actually have a patch, and this patch tried to add a suffix similar to GCC, and I think that it's already been approved, and it should be merged fully very soon. Probably there's some test errors. Yeah. Okay, let's go to the next one. Another thing is also function signature change is a document promotion. This is very similar to CCCI RA transformation. So let's see for this work. Basically, report with three arguments here. And there's a no return, there's a die here somewhere. And this is the string. This fixed. There's no variable, it's fixed. And so compiler actually removes this directly, put inside this function. So actually in this report, three parameter become two. And you can see here, the first one is gone. And this only available, this optimization the argument promotion is only available at O3 or LTO, including both LTO and free LTO. And so, similar to the dead argument elimination and the argument promotion, and we also need a suffix here. And here we will, for the promotion side, we will have argument promotion. And I actually added a return promotion as well. And because sometimes the return value is removed because nobody really used the return value, and the argument stays the same. In that case, it will have a return. Yeah, of course, and here there's a different ways to inspect, and through IR or remarks or assembly code. Once we have a suffix, it will make things easier. And just like a GCC, you will be immediately know that there's something changed. For the LTO, and the LTO doesn't really change function signature, it just promotes the functions from static to global and add a .llvm.hash. So there's a different functions here, some examples. It covers both static function and a static variable. And in this here program, here we have a patch actually fixed the LLVM basically a dash hash for the variable side. And for example, you have a variable and you use this static variable in BPL program, but you cannot really have this hash because it's not portable, right? And it could be from this kernel version to the next kernel version. You may have LLVM hash 1, next version, maybe LLVM.hash 2, or maybe it doesn't really have LLVM hash at all. And in this particular case, libvpf need to handle this and just ignore this .llvm hash if it's there. So you try to match. The signature doesn't change it, so it's okay. And the full LTO is a little bit more complicated, and because it all with this numbers, it's a sequential, and tell you, okay, you can see in this particular case, the kernel actually has at least like a close to 20,000 lines of code, 200,000 functions, actually it's pretty big. And again, full LTO doesn't really change the function signature. There is a problem for static, and the element will address probably already addressed in the PAPL, and you can see the suffix is not the same. For example, data RC map, this one, and the pixel view thing, and there are multiple copies, and this one as well. And this is the PAPL need to be handled. Okay, now come to the interest inline. And this is a big difference between GCC and the CLAP. And the first example you can see is really simple, and we just return a constant. We have this no inline, right? You there, suppose you will be no inline. Inline means no inline. You should be just call this function and function and the foo and it should return 5, and then the should return the result of the foo. If not, this. Go ahead and basically return the file. And for the single variable, it is the same. It will directly return the variable. And since it's in this particular case, and it's a foo file, and it goes to V, and V is supposed to return a foo to file. And the compiler is really smart. It will just say, okay. 5 actually just 5, let's just return 5. And so this is another interesting thing. A little bit more complex, it will not inline. So this is just whatever the class is the fixed thing. It doesn't have this one. This is the no inline means no inline. Just something. And how to work around these things? There's a tool workaround. The first thing is add some inline assembly, and in this case, you just add a sync, it will work. give up, and so you will be fine. Another is weak. You add a weak attribute to the function, you will be okay too. Because you are coping, and you're coping. Now, there are several passes and several optimizations for GCC, and now come to the GCC side. Function inline is called part and dot subject. And basically, the part of the program and portion of control flow gets inlined, and the rest of that remains in the original function. I actually have a partial inlining pass, but disabled by default. I try to enable this partial inlining to see whether the kernel actually crash. Obviously, not actually. Let's look at an example actually in the kernel. SK and receive check. And we have a bunch of statements here, and they will, this is the source code. The actual partial inlining happens like this. And they will promote the first, basically, if statement out of this function. And then they call the call. So this theoretically could impact chasing. So if you're chasing, try to all cases including this return ENXIO, no XIO, and then you may miss some cases. So this is assembly code, and so the part zero, and you can look at the assembly code, it's very clear here. And it have this if access device does not equal this CC, and the first one is actually this one. SK is bound, is gone in assembly code. So, for this part thing, if you really say, okay, you want to chase the function based on its functionality, you need to check the assembly code to see exactly what are functions in line. Okay, now it's a constant propagation. This is actually a change function signature as well. And for this JHash is a basically static inline function, but it's not inline in many places. And it has jhash and constant propagation 0, 0, 0 because it's a static function. It becomes a static function in its respective file. And this initial value in many cases is 0. So that's why they dwell. And this is a cosite and a bunch of cosite, and you can see there's only two parameters instead of three. So unfortunately, in this case, they have this location, they didn't really specify parameter name, so you have to have some kind of like a you wish, actually, those three parameters become two, and which two, I mean, not really clear. The last one is interprocedure scalar replacement aggregate. This actually could replace aggregate with some simple values. I think that's a main purpose. It could be remove some unused parameter as well. So this is an example. And again, and I think in the BPF directory. And there's a BPF map get memcp, basically a memory control group. And it, this map parameter, it has map to CG, and they use this again, they do this. And the transformation has become UFC group, this guy, and you can see it's replaced. This is what compiler will do. So this is doing. This is the assembly code again, and for this kind of stuff, you really need to look at assembly code to see whether you're chasing this function will make sense or not, whether it's basically conformed to your functionality or not. In this particular case, you see, although we have this map object CD, you can have a bunch of push. Here, you just have a GE not equal, or you go somewhere. So essentially, this line, if map, this line does not really match here, and we don't have a load here. So all of them, but portion of all problems I'm mentioning about.
My name's Alan. So, pretty good fact in the situation, I suppose. You're not doing an amazing job of describing all of these things, but we're dealing with a lot of complexity here. And I think what we've got to bear in mind moving forward is, what do we actually want to represent to the BPF system and elsewhere? And some of the guiding principles around this, what I'm going to talk about shortly. This is what I want to describe. Is how BLG as well as today and how we can do better in the future. So, the real world impact is in all of this as well, because when we take an intervention program, we're trusting the BTF representation that we use to accurately represent what we actually attach to and use. So, if you get that information wrong, that's bad news, then things can go badly very quickly. So, in BTF, today, the way we handle this in BTF is we're quite conservative in what we represent in BTF. So, example, we offer things like optimizations or inconsistent representations of functions across compilation units that we can ask for from. We basically just skip that PDF representation, but we can do a little bit better than that, so we're going to talk a little bit about that too. We're not really as interested in things like the hot code splits, because they don't really correspond to anything in the source code. I think we really want to deal with a representation that's somewhat stable despite what level of optimization we use. So, we're sort of when we do our BTF representation, what we're really saying is the stuff in the source code, this is the stuff that corresponds to that when it's actually compiled. So I'm going to describe a couple of ways where we can go a little bit further than that in the future, and hopefully we can represent this a little bit more. Because one of the downsides of this is reducing the trace and search of the system. I mean, as you probably know, it's probably a lie, so we end up missing a lot of functions. I mean, I don't know about you, but the first thing in my company is people come to me and ask me to trace a function. That's one of the first things people do with BPF. They go like this on board to BPF experience, and inevitably what happens is the function they want to inline. So then you can't trace it. And then we have to go, we go to the core of the function, that's probably been inline too, and or it's missing the argument they're interested in. So that's the real world implications for people's experience with BPF as well, just on a kind of sense as well. So, and there is going to be good news, I promise, is that at the moment, we actually provide dwarf information at multiple stages of the compilation process. So you get late dwarf as well after optimizations have been applied. So you can kind of marry all that information together, understand a little bit better at a particular function, what you wind up with, like did a parameter get optimized out. So this is really useful for the ISRA functions. You can actually look at them and go, okay, well, is the function signature matching what I expect than the original dwarf? Has something changed? And we have these, what are they called, annotations, which point back to the original parameters so we can see if that one changed. And currently what we do at the moment is we just leave those representations out because we don't really have any way of representing different call styles and how different call styles might behave, because in some cases, function appears in multiple places, not multiple instances, and they can all be different in terms of what they represent. So, you know, keep that in mind because we're going to try and improve our representations to handle those type of things. So, when we do dwarf BTF generation, we compare across all the different compilation units and look for inconsistencies like these. Some of them can derive from compilation optimizations. Some can actually just be static functions in different compilation units have the same name and have totally different function signatures. Obviously, in a case like that, you eventually the wrong inputs, you're getting totally bogus parameters. So at the moment, again, we're conservative and we leave out representing those functions. We don't really have any way of exactly representing a function for the site, instance of a function, like a multiple ones. I think that's really what's missing here. So, you know, we have names for functions, and names are really the only thing that ties a function representation of BTF to a chaos contention, which tells us where that address is. And that's not really enough. In some cases, things are optimized out, and you can have multiple things that match that name, but they've got different suffixes, like they can be a hot and a cold. And we just have the pixels match the name. We don't know which actually corresponds to the function. You know, things can be complicated. We're missing that connection, essentially. So one thing we've talked about for a while is actually having addresses. Functions representatives in BTF, and I think that would give us a huge boost in a number of different ways. have a .is array function. UTF representation doesn't have that .is array suffix because dwarf doesn't as well. It's sort of, and it has back to the stability notion that we want to have a stable representation aside from any kind of optimization that happens. But you have a way of linking that UTF function prototype with the actual function call site, things become much, much less ambiguous and we get a bit more clarity. And the other area that's a big problem, particularly in Linux, where things are so heavily in mind, is you know, there's so many inline sites. If your number of these makes representing them somehow expensive, the flip side of that is because you can take a K-probe and attach it within a function body, if you have enough information about those call sites, it would be really, really valuable to be able to, trace. Edward Zimmer did some fantastic work here, and this is where the good news starts. And so he looked at some of these inline sites, and it turns out that 67% of them for LLVM preserve parameters in an accessible way, so they might be on the stack, they might not be in the register, they would be for the standard calling conventions, but they're not available. So the good news, I reran the data developed here on the GPT-compiled kernel. Numbers were a little lower, but in the ballpark. So I suggest that the way of gathering this information, if we have extra information about specific sites of a function, in case of inline, whether those sites can be a function boundaries, but it's going to be valuable. So for LLVM, I just want to mention briefly here that we don't have as much information as we have in GCC because we have the late dwarf information where we can make these comparisons. So it would be nice if we could get late dwarf information for LLVM compilation as well, because that would give us a chance to see parameter optimization. So this information we're kind of blind to at the moment with LLVM. So that would be a nice feature to have in the future. I think some of the other presentations, like the remarks, I think Yonghong mentioned, yeah, they're probably a little bit too wordy. So if we could get late dwarf representations, we can operate on it with PAL, that would be great. So just a method, the other thing to mention, aside from optimization systems, there's a couple of hundred functions in the kernel where the same names use the different compilation units and its different function signatures. Another thing that we have to just actually leave out, so that means a dep entry attached to this. So again, when we're just the tracing service of the system to prioritize safety, if we look at our BTF representation, I think it's going to be possible if we expand the way we represent BTF to actually expand the tracing service of the system and maintain the safety that we have today. So the direct information is quite part of the BTF. So if we have these two function signatures here, but if we had a way to tie the BTF views of the function to the addresses, then you can actually disambiguate things. And if you have an F entry program, you can actually take the BTF representation of that F entry and tie it to the specific site or sites and connect to it safely, and you know you're doing the right thing. So that's one example where address information would help. Actually, the same with the optimized things, when we have these .is array functions. Can get unambiguous mapping if we have, sort of particular function prototype. We know what address or particular function, we know what address that function is at. That will help too. We could also use addresses to mark inline sites as well. It's going to be expensive to do it. We probably would want to do it before kernel VM Linux, but we could do it elsewhere in a few Linux extras. So we also, though, for cases like inline optimizations, want to know about cases where the parameter is missing or in a different register. So, as well as having location information, as well as having address information, we would need to have a way to abstract information about that particular site, what parameters are available, what parameters are missing, and where we can actually get them. So, in terms of encoding, if we're going to have site specific information for the core kernel functions, we're looking at about 60,000 functions, we really don't want to load BTF. We don't want to leak absolute addresses either because BTF is world readable, so we need to kind of think about those things. We need to use base relative addresses. We need to just the representation of the function, the name, and then it points to the prototype, so it points to another BTF client, which is the prototype. So ideally, I think what we should do is preserve those semantics for cases where any place that function exists. The function prototype. So then, if the BTF kind of function doesn't point to the prototype, what is the same, like a bit more complicated in this case. So, what that gives us is preserve these different behaviors where we can safely attach like find func pointing at find func total, because then you can deal with a more complex situation. So yes, we have the PCF contact stack, which encodes variables and their locations. I think we just need to expand that to support information. So that, what I would suggest is we have, a type. So the type would be pointing at the client function, so that will give us the name. That which is the address. For example, that would be relevant to the detail section. And the location type. So this representation is basically for a particular the type will always point to the PDF client func. Think about that PDF client func itself, it may not point right at a prototype. So if it has the type ID 0, what that's basically saying is it's an encoding that says things are more complicated and you need to look at the actual special information to get the site specific representation. That gives people a little bit more interaction to play with. So this model is probably interesting to actually kind of describe how it would work. So in this case, we've got one function two. So this idea is 1,000. It's a client func. It's type reference is 0. So this is in this particular case where for this function we can't go directly from the function to the function prototype because maybe different to different sites. For bar, the same as 0 in one case, in another case, and then for a third function, it's actually got a client func which points. So that third function, what we can derive from this is every case that function exists, if there's multiple instances of it, we can find the function prototype safely. So in the two cases though where things are more complicated, we need to go and look at the data section, look at the particular site information. So for the function three, so what I've done here is for the top table here, which represents the actual BTF clients for various functions. I've expanded the client data set here, which contains all the different site-specific information. So that's site-specific information. We have site-specific information for the first function, too. We've got an address offset. It points to a new BTF client, which I'm proposing, which is the location client. That will actually give us string information at each location associated with the function parameters. We can just derive that from the dwarf location information. Well, that would give us some like stack offsets and things. We have something like this in USDT today, where we actually have kind of strings which represent where we actually get the parameters from. So that's particularly the case where, so it could be in line potentially, that might not actually even be a function boundary. Gather parameter information from locations which have, some of the locations may not actually have information available, but I guess it would have a string representing zero, a null string essentially. So one of the parameters might be missing, and that's how we represent that. It could be in line. It could also have a consistent representation. In other words, it could be a case where we've optimized a parameter, we've got a constant propagation or something like that. And in that case, then we'd also need the location information to tell us that particular location, how we actually map what the parameter should have been to where we actually find that information. So in the case of bar, it's a simple one. We're just pointing out a function prototype. Here. So this is the partial inline case, which is kind of, we don't deal with it well today. So today in PAL, if the function is partially aligned, we're blind to the inline instances of it. So essentially we look and we have the PTF representation as consistent. So we represent the PTF, but what happens is if you go to trace that function, you're only going to see the 9 times that fires. So we want to do better than that. So this is the way of representing cases where a function might be inline sometimes. Lined in other situations. So this is the case for this second function bar. So in one case, just conforms to the function prototype. In the second case, we need to get location information. So the idea here is really to provide an extra layer of information for the case where things are complex. The hope is, in most cases, it won't be your function, will just be looked up. But if things are more complicated, then this at least gives you a determine how to get the information that you want. And again, we're trying to move from the original code, representations of the functions in the code, to what is actually running on the system. So, to try and bridge that gap, location information would be a way of doing that. So, in terms of cost, we'd be talking of 60,000 functions by bytes for the data set information. So, it's 700K or so. That's for the core functions themselves. If we think about location information for cases which are inconsistent, there's about multiple operations of the function or kind of the optimization. So, you know, we probably need about 700 to 1,000 of them, so you're talking about over 21K. So, the core kernel would be about, you know, what, under a megabyte, I think, for the time of this information available. So, I think that would be valuable to have. Now, moving to inline, you know, things get big fast. You know, from average numbers, there's 300,000 inlines. The service them has quite the information that we can use, but for the ones that don't have quite information, we can just not have a location for them. And even just knowing that these lines are sometimes useful information, I mean, it's better than nothing. Actually, it can be quite informational to know that a particular function is being hit, even if you can't actually gather any information on that site. So, to get all that information about the lines, you're talking about next year. 10 megabytes or so. So when you add together the existing kernel BTF and that, you know, you're talking about less than 20 megabytes, which is still pretty small compared to, you know, an optimistic case by 400 megabytes of dwarf and often it can stretch to gigabytes. So the idea would be essentially to separate out things like the static representations, the inline representations, into an extra file that could be optimally compiled. It would be interesting via module as well. Because it would give us a way of seeing things we can't see today. So we're blind to a lot of this stuff at the moment. We can't see inline functions. We can't eventually attach functions which have complex representations and have, in some places, have parameters optimized out. So this is hope, I think, is a potential approach to solve this. We could even have a sort of auto-attach, which is like it corresponds to like K-probe, maybe inline for a function, and then it goes and looks at all these locations. Does a multi-attach to them and handles the parameters, tells us the parameters are. We have something like this for USDT today, as I said, so you can imagine doing something like that, which we did a site-specific analysis and give you the information you wanted. So with all this information available, I think we can do a lot better.
Just a comment. Can do that. If you are trying to use the command,
Probe
actually that supports the inline function and inline parameters. Of course, the summer parameters are gone. It will fail because the data is not accessible. Actually, that supports the inline function. So that if you use the summer inline function, then it will make a different, several different.
Just all these amazing things. Every time we talk to Arnaldo, I find out all these new capabilities. So,
okay, thank you for solving the
issue. That's optimization. Yeah, it's a trick. The other thing is, as well, that you don't have dwarf available. You need some kind of representation of this stuff. Most people don't have dwarf locally. So, the idea here is can we get a minimized representation that will give people enough to solve problems?
I think this is all really nice when you're someone who has to look at part of it, the DDoS and read it right, not generation. But my only giant new BTF lock and the fact that we just continue gigantic split, there's a more structured way to think this. If we think about it, it will probably also be significantly smaller. With three consumers, like in part of the screen, it might be more work, but the result might be better. We're thinking it through, we just sort of consider it and ignore it, but I think we need to break it down into something less heavy before we actually implement it.
I suppose the only thing to mention would be that we get spring deep as well, so if you've got the same register representations again and again and again.
Yeah, well, DDoS will happen regardless once you even see DDoS everything.
But that's a good point. I think we should think about what representation makes sense. The only challenge is when you've got to do cross-platform things then within PAO or whatever.
I have a sort of weird before which PTF could pick up, which would essentially give us an unbounded number of be useful for this. You could have architecture dependent things and that sort of stuff. It's in my Colton talk, which is attached to my DS talk on here. It's people who just need it.
Let's go take a look. Thank you. So that's pretty much it. This is the table there, the summary of the problems and so forth. So, yeah, I think the takeaways are, I think LLVM could add some information about late dwarf representation, and we could bootstrap from that. With a couple of additions to BTF, I think we can do a much better place where we're exposing a much larger place to service to users.
Sorry, maybe a stupid question. I don't know much about the kernel. I know some things about compilers. And but split functions, function cloning has been easy at least maybe 20 years, right? Makes sense. And there are people who are crazy enough or brave enough to debug optimized code, right? So they have to GDB or LDB. And the problem is they essentially have to solve the same problems that we're trying to solve. And if you look into experience like what debuggers had to do, you know, libraries and all, it's that.
Yeah, I mean, I think the challenge with debuggers is they generally work with dwarf, which has specific information that has the whole language describing, if I'm at this certain point in the function list where these things are available, and that gets very heavyweight very fast. So what we're trying to do here is kind of bridge the gap between maximizing the available trace information while keeping it as small as possible. So that's the kind of trade-off.
If I understand correctly, the concern is with the size of work.
Yeah.
How about my custom compiler? Minimal dwarf. You don't need maybe lineup information, unless you don't need type information. What you really want is like inline information, cross-site information, right? The arguments. I don't know if it's already an option like that available, but it's definitely useful not only for EVPN. It will be quicker, it will be used for debuggers, right? It will be useful for any tracing class.
Yeah, one of the challenges with work for the kernel, at least, is that it's not too duplicated, so you get a huge amount of, we need type information for this stuff as well, so you get a huge amount of information that you've kind of got to boil down, that's where the deduplication comes in, so without deduplication, I think from the way you can define it today, for some embedded folks, that they actually complain about, but the Linux BTS actually is so big, you want to show data to a separate module. That we're going to have to look at as well.
So, sitting down a dwarf years ago, this was the kernel and all modules for an enterprise kernel. Dwarf was 15 gigs, which is a bit much. All the fine stuff, including all the modules, was still 400 meg plus. It was a way too big for any non-debugging. But these people complain about 18 meg. Can you make it 16 or 12 or 8? They're never going to go about hundreds of megabytes. We need a more compact representation, and the non-deduplicated dwarf is just not compact, I'm afraid. Obviously, we don't want to throw away anything important. Dwarf is not specialized for compactness, it's just this is what you know.
So the idea is to convert dwarf to like a different format, like extract the most important parts or until you convert them and make it available to, I guess, everyone, right? Not just the kernel.
Yeah, no, that's the thing. So what we find a lot of the time is when you're debugging a problem, it's not even an option. Customers won't let you download the dwarf information after the fact. So the fact that BTF travels with the kernel, it's embedded in the kernel image and modules as well, is such a winner. I mean, driving force behind that, the reason we can do that essentially is because it's small. So smallness is really the key feature, I think. We can play with a little bit to improve the representation, I think, but the limitations are very real. So I think we have to be careful about it.
Thank you. objects, whatever, and then you don't really need a dwarf reader. Dwarf has another problem, which is that, yes, you could turn dwarfs to the minimum, but you still need a full dwarf reader. Even if you clean the information that you are conveying, you still need to be able to process dwarf expressions of these dwarfs. Regardless of how much information you have in the.
So when you talk about the location, do you think that is the location of the arguments? Exact location. Okay.
Yeah.
So even so, then my follow-up question would be: even currently, the compiler does find situations where it cannot keep track of where the arguments lie. Like if the compiler optimizes it out, then what I'm getting at is, does it make sense to have something like for really need tracing, we add some sort of extra hints to the compiler that this function needs to be absolutely traceable, so do not do any cookie optimization with it so that the arguments are traceable.
Yeah, actually, we get back to the compiler of APL funks because we're going to example of this where you really want to make sure the function signature matches what you've asked for. So you have to include all sorts of magic words to get that to work, but it did just work. But yeah, absolutely, it's just that's very important.
You can know upfront all the functions that will be interesting to test. Like, basically, every function can be interesting.
Yeah, I think some combination of known inline keywords. I don't remember now, but.
He should be saying this because he's been kind of overseeing this work. But I mean, so BPF Trace has just introduced inlining support, kernel inlining, and that's obviously using dwarf. It's a monster pain, really. So it's LLDB and doing the dwarf reading there, but obviously if CTF can. I just want to check, so you're doing the location expression encoding, it's what you want to do so we can actually find the arguments for the inline instances.
Yeah, so that would be the aim in the end. So you'd actually be able to say, okay, let me give you the name, translate that to all the sites that that one is. Mm-hmm. For each of those sites, give me the mapping between the parameters that I would expect from the source code of what actually wound up happening. So I can do that way, I think.
Right, okay, but not doing any form of state machine, obviously, for the location expression.
Yes, because that's doing the land. Yeah, I meant to say this actually. For the earlier question, where is it?
It's the madness there.
Yeah, the numbers that were found were say 2/3 of functions had accessible location information, which meant it was like on the stack or in another register. So I think for the most part, you can get that info, so it's great. This was a really nice surprise when I discovered this. I thought the number would be, if you asked me before, by 20% if you're lucky. I think it will help definitely.
So, I was hiding with the duplicate symbol in another using there. And talking with Paul's side, it came out that somehow I may have considered to approach the duplicate symbol thing using BPF. But talking with people, it seems like that in BTF this very problem is not considered. Or to say better, when you find a duplicate symbol, you simply stick the rest of the symbol with the same name. So I was wondering, is there any plan to tackle this very problem? And also, if it happened, because it happened, for example, when the compiler doesn't inline a function from an header, that you have multiple copies of the same function in various places, and you have one of these functions that for optimization problem has a different signature than in other places. Is there any consideration of this special use case?
So the double checker use case, I think one place to try, which is like the 26 messages with it and the chaos one. So I can add it to get the error, which says static in line as a function definition. So get in lines, get a copy of it every time you include that error. Those cross check the function feature. So in this case, we would bring up actually here. We might have some cases where representations would match the function. We have other cases which they wouldn't. So we can represent that absolute because we have location information now. So we can say at this price, match the feature at this price, it didn't, and this parameter is gone. So yeah, that essentially solves that problem. So today we have to be conservative and just omit this information, but we can do better in the future if we have specified information, which can give us information about inlines and functions. So I think that's
thank you.
Do we have to encode it in the BTF file, so we should add like a separate segment or something? Or like on the call side?
Yeah, I mean, the format that we're trying to really match very closely to the BTF data set that we have today for variables. So, like inclination would be, if we can at all do it in BTF, particularly for functions, at least whatever that in times, that would be a nice way to go. The only challenge we have there is what folks really care about, not really too much information about kernel addresses. This kernel BTF is world readable, so we need to be careful about where we expose that information, because it might actually be the actors, the index might be the place to do it, I don't know. Or, like you said, maybe another alphabet or something like that.
I mean,
that was because there is now a clear case of early and late BTF information. This does meddle with if and when you're linking these sections, which means that there should be something that you should identify as this is the best section for a linker to operate on. I'm not sure what the answer is, but again, I think that my comment is in the same lines that this should see which fits the linker better and work from there.
Yeah, I mean, the way we kind of work this debate today is with the abstract origin of the dwarf representation points, the original function, so we can kind of infer the temporal structure of how that was done by saying, okay, this point's back at that, so this must have happened afterwards. So, yeah, there's no real sense of time in that other than just what we infer from the structure. So, yeah, it's something to think about, definitely.
I think we should start. And the question to the public is, do we need like 5 minutes break? 5 or 10? Let's do 10 minutes break and yeah, 5 or 10.
Thank you.